It's a long road to peace in Mindanao, one that is beset with challenges but also opportunities. How do we ensure peace will last in the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao? And how do we make sure it will continue this way? Will we see finally just and lasting peace in the region?
Today, let's continue our conversation about a certain dream, an aspiration of a people for their homeland. Let's talk about the promises and plans of our fellow Filipinos who have long been struggling with historical injustices and socioeconomic challenges. I'm Ron Cruz.
And I'm Karen Davila. This is ANC Presents Bangsamoro and Beyond, produced in partnership with BARM, the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, OPAP, the Office of the Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process, the Asia Foundation, and the British Embassy in Manila. This is the fourth edition of our forum, engaging as many stakeholders in the Bangsamoro community as much as possible. This time, it's going to be a deliberate conversation between and among the Bangsamoro.
Hopes remain high for lasting peace in Mindanao. This more than a year since the establishment of the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, or BARM. The new regional government is part of a peace deal signed between the Philippine government and the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, or MILF. It's seen as a huge step towards finally achieving peace in the region. In its first year, the Bangsamoro clinched several major accomplishments, including forming a transitional government called the Bangsamoro Transition Authority, or BTA, institutionalizing moral governance, drafting a budget for the region, and decommissioning thousands of fighters who have struggled for decades in their homeland. The BTA serves as the interim parliament of the Bangsamoro until democratic elections are held in 2022. But that interim Bangsamoro parliament has asked Congress to extend the transition period of the region's expanded autonomous government for another 3 years. When Congress decides to do so, the schedule of the first regular elections in BARM will be moved to 2025. Malacanang says President Rodrigo Duterte, the country's first president from Mindanao, will help Bangsamoro authorities seek an extension of the transition period for the region. The autonomous Bangsamoro government will be parliamentary democratic, similar to the United Kingdom, and based on a political party system. This means that in the first regular elections under BARM, registered voters shall elect their representatives in the Bangsamoro Assembly. These representatives, in turn, shall elect the region's chief minister among themselves. This is different from the presidential setup, where voters directly elect the president, the vice president, senators, aside from their lawmakers and local officials. Under the Bangsamoro government, the chief minister is indirectly elected. But the system is still democratic because the members of the parliament will be elected as representatives of the Bangsamoro people. Consistent with the 1987 Constitution, the executive and legislative branches in a parliamentary system shall be elected and representative of its constituent political units. The chief minister heads the cabinet, which exercises executive power. The cabinet is composed of two deputy chief ministers and ministers from the members of the parliament. Aside from serving as the head of the regional government, the chief minister has the power to issue executive orders and set a platform of government, among others. The term of office for the chief minister is 3 years. The parliament has the power to enact laws, conduct inquiries in aid of legislation, pass the annual budget, to name a few. The parliamentary shall be composed of 80 members. Representatives of political parties comprise half of the body, while 40% come from parliamentary districts. At least 10%, or no less than 8, are reserved seats and sectoral representatives. The term of a member of the parliament shall be 3 years, with a maximum limit of 3 consecutive terms. The Wali is considered the titular head of the BARM, performing ceremonial duties, including the moral guardianship of the region. The parliament will select a wali from a list of residents in the Bangsamoro submitted by the Council of Leaders. When the transition period from ARM to the Bangsamoro ends, the negotiating panels of the Philippine government and the MILF shall review and evaluate the implementation of their agreements. They may draft and sign an exit document that officially terminates a peace negotiation if all agreements have been fully implemented. Parties will also implement a normalization process that helps the Bangsamoro communities attain sustainable livelihood as well as political participation. These include the decommissioning of MILF forces, implementing socio-economic programs for the development of the Bangsamoro, and putting in place transitional justice mechanisms to help heal the wounds of long-term conflict.
And with us today, we have Moro Islamic Liberation Front Panel Chair Minister Mohager Iqbal, who also heads the Ministry of Basic, Higher and Technical Education of the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, and co-chairs the Intergovernmental Relations Body and member of Interim Bangsamoro Parliament, Nabil Tan. I would like to start our discussion by this question. Where is the peace process right now, and how important is this extension? Chair Minister Iqbal, do the honor, sir.
As to where we are now in relation to the peace process, we have already heard the most difficult, the most arduous part of the search for peace and justice in Mindanao. And we are now in the implementing stage. And that's the reason why the peace panel of government and the MILF are now changed into peace implementing panel. We are implementing all those agreements signed by between the government and of the Republic of the Philippines and the MILF. And one of the most important aspects of the implementation phase is the normalization track. We have to normalize the situation in Mindanao, and we have to transform the life of each combatant from a combat life into a productive civilian life. And more importantly, we need to have peace, justice, and development in Mindanao. There are many challenges. And as far as the MILF peace implementing panel is concerned, we are about 30% to 40% in our implementation of the normalization track. And then alongside that, we need also to look at the other track, which is the implementation of the provisions of the Bangsamoro Organic Law, because the two tracks, the normalization track and the political track, are intertwined. They are interlocked with each other. It's not enough that you look at the normalization track. You need to look at the political track, because they are two sides of the same coin. In fact, I have to say here that the political track is just a legal implementation of the agreements of the government and that of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, although it did not capture all of the provisions of the agreements of the government and MILF, especially the framework agreement on the Bangsamoro and the comprehensive agreement on the Bangsamoro, but 85% has already been captured by the Bangsamoro Organic Law. So as a result of that, while we are still trying to assert the 15% through reforms, through enactment of laws, but we already consider the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao as our government. That's why we are so concerned about moving forward in terms of the implementation of the two tracks as far as the peace process is concerned.
Honorable Nabil Tan, perhaps you can expound, why is the extension vital, and what do you expect to achieve from with the extension?
A lot of things has to be implemented in the BOL. You have an interagency committee that has to be, that has never been organized, Office of the President, Civil Service, and DPM, just to show that the separate the liabilities and obligations of the national from the regional. You also have to to activate the Council of Leaders so that there will be advices for the they can advise the Chief Minister on governance. So this has never been convened yet. Mm. And these are things that needs to be done.
What is causing these delays? If it's very important, what is with the bureaucracy that it isn't running as fast as it should be?
Nabanggit ko lang sa normalization based on reports kasi hindi na po ako member ng government panel. Mm-mm. Dati po, alam ko po ang facing niyan, pati number of combatants to be decommissioned. And then, so, very important po dahil masasayang, inumpisan na natin, hindi natin itutuloy, eh what gives, di ba?
No.
I mean, at ito, may kalakip na yung mandate namin is part to have a level playing field by passing that electoral code which will democratize even more the choosing of candidates kasi 50% will be party candidates and plus the districts plus the 8 sectoral to be elected from amongst their group. So masasayang po, and then the Bangsamoro, the COMELEC National should establish the Bangsamoro Electoral Office. Na I understand recently they passed a resolution to establish the Bangsamoro Electoral Office kasi different po ang elections namin dahil parliamentary form kami, unitary ang national. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So ang daming gagawin, and mag-register ka ng political parties, party build-up.
Mm-hmm. What are the challenges that you want improved? Is bureaucracy still an issue considering that this is landmark legislation?
Madam Karen, I will answer the first question. How important the extension is to the nation? May kasabihan sa Tagalog na sakit ng kalingkingan ay sakit ng buong katawan. Secondly, solving the problem, what we call the Moro problem or Bangsamoro problem, which is a centuries-old problem, is a national interest. A national interest. It's not only the interest of the Moro people, nor of the Bangsamoro-Tormos region in Muslim Mindanao, or probably even Mindanao. It's a national interest. We need to solve this one.
Yes.
It has been ongoing for the so many decades. It started during the Spanish, I think 5 centuries already. So, kailangan i-address na natin ito. And then, pangatlo, kahit na si President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, President Aquino, then President Duterte, lagi nila sinasabi yung legitimate grievances ng Bangsamoro people. Legitimate, even the United States of America, especially President Bush, really recognize the legitimate grievances of the Bangsamoro people. So, kailangan natin i-address ito eh. Pag na-address natin ito, yung mga ibang lalaban sa gobyerno, eh wala na silang issues against the government. So pag hindi natin ma-address ito, ay talagang yung problema, hindi mawawala. Hindi mawawala. Kaya kailangan natin ito, ma-address itong legitimate grievances. And anong formula? Ang formula na sa Framework Agreement of Bangsamoro, nasa Comprehensive Agreement of Bangsamoro, and then yung Bangsamoro Organic Law captures 85% of the 2 essential agreements. So kailangan natin talaga i-resolve ito. I repeat, it is a national interest of the Republic of the Philippines to solve this problem.
Yes.
What caused the delay?
Yeah.
Alam niyo po yung normalization track as a implementation of the provisions of Bangsamoro Organic Law. Process po naman po yan eh. Ang proseso po, kailangan mayroon din mga steps dyan, mga sub-processes po, kailangan sundin po natin yung mga processes po na yan. Kasi pag hindi natin sinunod yan po, hindi talaga magiging maganda yung implementation po natin. We cannot cut corners. A process. We need to follow the sequence. The sequencing has to be followed. Cutting of corners is not the language of the day. So yun po ang isang dahilan kung bakit medyo matagal. Napatagal. Actually, medyo matagal dahil proseso po ito.
Okay, but Chair Minister, is government keeping up their end of the bargain? Are they keeping up to it in terms of timing, the aid that should be given, or could they do better? Could government do better?
Well, in fairness to the government, we're partners in the implementation, both in the normalization track and in the implementation of the provisions of the Bangsamoro Organic Law, especially the Intergovernmental Relations Body of the National Government and lot of the BARM. In fairness to them, talagang nagtutulungan po kami, pero talagang hindi ho kaya na madaliin ito eh. Hindi ho kaya.
On the part of the national government, let me just clear up some issues. No, block grants is not solely for development. Ang block grants po in 2020 was 63 billion. And I guess my information is only 53 has been released. Wala pa yung November-December yata. So may lag na 10 billion. For next year, we're trying to budget the block grants of about 73 billion something for the operations and of the Ministry and Development. The division of the block grants is 45% PS and 55% development. So, meron din po another fund, yung Special Development Fund, supporting the national government. 5 billion a year. Meron pong 2.5 na na-release. According to my information, meron pa kulang na 2.5. But I guess it's just the process. But towards before the end of the year, it might be released also. So, yun po ang...
Okay, so very quickly, we are ending the year already. You are still expecting 10 billion from the block grant to be released. And you're not considering this a delay?
Hindi naman po basta-basta i-release ng DBM unless you complete all the requirements. Nasa BOL din po, plans and programs should be clear. Pag walang programa po, walang release. That's part of it... conversation in the House of Representatives. I was seated beside Sunny Dominguez. Yan ang ano niya. Hindi basta-basta ibubuhos sa'yo.
At walang programa, sir.
By month.
So does this mean that all the requirements for the program has not yet been fully submitted?
I am not privy, ma'am, but my information is there is still a balance of 10 billion. But ma'am, for your information and for the education of those yung dito nanonood sa programa na to, ang ano namin, ang pondo namin hindi na po nagre-revert sa National Treasury. It will remain with the Bangsamoro Regional Treasury with the FDMS. So yun po ang pagbabago.
Okay.
So we can still avail of that.
In other words, pondo nyo pa rin yan even next year. Okay. Now,
idadagdag po yun sa budget ng next year.
Now, Ron Cruz is monitoring the conversation on social media. So, Ron, what are people saying?
Thanks for that, Karen. We're going to read some of the comments on social media. We did ask, do you think the BARM or the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao would result in just and lasting peace in the region? Facebook user Prime Ragandang says, yes, one thing I like most with the current mechanisms in BARM is how its youth proactive agency harmonizes with the wisdom of the region's elders. Positive intergenerational power dynamics, as they say, and I hope it sustains. That's what he said. For Delicious says, yes, it does. It's the ultimate goal of all laws, peace, and order. However, its sustainability will depend on its leaders if the Bangsamoro Organic Law is implemented right. If the leaders, or most of them, are corrupt and only have their personal political agenda, the BARM is bound to collapse. Here's one question from youth leader Suwaidi Alba Ibrahim.
Kalakip po ba ng extension ng transition period na ito ang pagplan ng Bangsamoro Transition Authority on drafting a bill about pandemic hazard calamity preparedness that will ensure the lives of the Bangsamoro people even in times of pandemic?
Go ahead.
Sure, meron din silang, nandiyan naman si MP Raisa de Jury, who is Minister of Social Welfare, they all have their COVID programs. In fact, sa deliberation namin sa budget for 2021, marami po kaming marami pong nakita akong programa na addressing this COVID, especially on housing. May housing ang Chief Minister, may housing ang social services. So we wanted the, as Parliament member, we wanted to, you know, I mean, delineate what are those housing, because there are lots of billions of pesos aside from the Marawi rehabilitation.
We also have with us Froilin Mendoza. She's the Executive Director of the Teduray Labangian Women's Organization. Froilin, welcome. Go ahead and ask your question.
In the light of the implementation of these normalization tracks, for instance, ay patuloy pa rin yung mga recurring conflict, kalimbawa, na nangyayari sa ating komunidad. At ang pinakalites nga po dito ay nangyari noong December 2, wherein 310 households were affected. These are all indigenous community sa isang barangay sa South UP, which is in Barangay Itaw in South UP. So equivalent to 52 families were displaced by this attack coming from the armed groups.
Minister Iqbal, can we hear from you, please?
Yung problema po natin, especially sa upper part ng Maguindanao, in particular sa South UP po, essentially po, it's about land ownership conflict po. At ito po ay nag-umpisa as early as the 1970s, kung saan yung depredation po ng so-called ilaga, dyan naman talaga nag-start sa UPI. Yung si Toothpick po, Feliciano Loses. So basically, gaya na sinabi ko, it's about land conflict, land issues. On the part of the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, we already constituted a task force to look into the problem and find ways really to address those issues. And then we also tasked the Ministry of Environment, Natural Resources and Energy really to fast track the resolution of the land conflict there in partnership with the Ministry of Indigenous Peoples Affairs.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, to those who are watching us, feel free to join us in this conversation by scanning the QR code you see on your screens or by clicking the quick survey link below. Up next, what are the implications of postponing the first and regular elections of BARM to 2025? The conversation continues when we return. This is ANC Presents Bangsamoro and Beyond, produced in partnership with BARM, the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, OPAP, the Office of the Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process, the Asia Foundation, and the British Embassy in Manila. President Rodrigo Duterte in favor of giving the new Bangsamoro Regional Government an extension of 3 years. This following various delays and setbacks caused, among others, by the COVID-19 pandemic. If this happens, the first regular elections in the new Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, or BARM, will not happen in 2022, but in 2025. Malacanang says President Duterte, the first president from Mindanao, will help Bangsamoro authorities seek an extension of the transition period for the region. The palace adds the extension needs the approval of Congress because there was a law that set the end of the transition period in 2022.
Ang sabi niya, tutulong siya para maamendahan ang batas na yan, pero kinakailangan talaga makipag-ugnayan ang mga taga-BARM sa ating mga kongresista at mga senador.
Earlier, Bangsamoro Interim Chief Minister Murad Ibrahim said the Bangsamoro Transition Authority, or BTA, would need more time in order to build the Bangsamoro's bureaucracy, pass foundational codes, and help former fighters improve their quality of life. This after peace advocacy group Mindanao People's Caucus, or MPC, recommended the extension of the transition period.
The group's recommendation is based on a midterm review it did on the process. Speaking on ANC's Matters of Fact, BARM Interior Minister Naguib Sinarimbo says the proposed three-year extension of the Bangsamoro transition period is necessary in hopes of completing essential work in the fledgling self-governing region in the country's troubled south. He adds the complex transition process, which began in 2019, was disrupted by the COVID-19 pandemic and had also faced budget delays in the past.
May consensus between the national government and the Bangsamoro government, the government of the day, as well as the peace panels in the government. So yung government at saka yung MILF na hindi matatapos yung essential work in the transition in the remaining period.
Sinarimbo says there are many obligations that the national government has yet to fulfill. Among them is a transfer of powers of national agencies to the Bangsamoro Autonomous Government. The proposed extension also getting the support of Presidential Peace Advisor Carlito Galvez Jr. Galvez, who also serves as the country's vaccine czar and chief implementer of the National Action Plan Against COVID-19, cited various challenges the government continues to face in the implementation of the comprehensive agreement on the Bangsamoro due to the coronavirus pandemic. But other stakeholders remain cool to the idea. On ANC, Cotabato City Mayor Cynthia Giani Sayadi criticized the proposal to extend the transition period.
More than 2 years na, ano pang nangyari? Nothing happened. And you talk about performance, you need another three years. Grabe ng paghihirap ng tao niyan, no?
Sayadi said the BTA, which serves as the interim government, did not listen to the complaints and concerns of the public. Issues such as delayed payment of salaries for teachers and healthcare workers have been unresolved. Sayadi earlier opposed the inclusion of Cotabato City, an independent city in Maguindanao province, but used to belong to Soksorjen in BARM. She had filed a petition before the Supreme Court questioning the results of the plebiscite. What are the repercussions of extending the transition period? Will the extension pose more benefits to the Bangsamoro region or not?
Welcome back to our conversation. We're now with BARM spokesperson Minister Sinarimbo, who heads the Ministry of the Interior and Local Government, and Assistant Secretary Wilben Mayor, member of the Government Implementing Peace Panel and spokesperson of the Office of the Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process, or OPAP. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us. Now, first off, originally the request or the appeal was for 6 years. It's down to three. Why 3 years? What can you achieve in 3 years?
The 3 years was a proposal from Congress, and ultimately yun ho yung naging provision ng batas. But from the very start, na Moro Islamic Liberation Front has always insisted na yung transition period will be for 6 years, and for good reasons. One is that the transition is not simply about a transition from ARM to BARM. It is also a transition for the MILF from a revolutionary ARM group to one that would now transition into a political party that will participate in democratic and peaceful processes for change. Yung complexity ho ng transition na yon, anticipated na natin. Unfortunately, our voices were not heard in Congress during the enactment of the organic law.
And do you believe with the 3 years, I'm just curious, very briefly, the president said it's still important to speak with lawmakers. Do you believe it'll be smooth sailing?
We've spoken to members of Congress and some members of the Senate. From the responses we're getting from the Speaker, the Majority Floor Leader, the Minority Floor Leader, and then the Majority Floor Leader of the Senate, members of the Senate, they're getting very good responses. They understood the need for extending the period of transition. They also believe that we need to safeguard the gains of the peace process and ensure that we do not revert to war in Mindanao.
Now, ASEC, let's talk about now the yearly block grants and their importance, no, in the Bangsamoro government. Number one first is there's still 10 billion that has not yet been released. What is the reason for that? And how can you ensure that these block grants will be spent and properly managed?
The 10 billion will remain again on the BARM government. It will be lodged on next year in case it will not be spent for this year. The block grant is provided by law, the annual block grant, coming from the collections from the Internal Revenues and from the Bureau of Customs. Again, this is provided by law and protected by law. Thus, it is up to the BARM on how to spend this kind of funds.
How can you ensure it's properly managed?
It depends on the BARM, how to manage it. But on the part of the national government, it is already provided for under the law. And the Department of Finance, we have, again, a mechanism on the Intergovernmental Relations Body, the Intergovernmental Fiscal Policy Board that oversees this kind of interventions between the national government and the BARM government.
There's still an oversight function, so to speak.
Based on the provisions of the law, the Intergovernmental Fiscal Policy Boards oversees this kind of activities of BARM, not really to dictate what the funds would be used, but again, to ensure the smooth support of the national government from the national government to BARM of this particular annual block grant as provided for by the Bangsamoro Organic Law.
The decommissioning of the forces of the MILF so far, I think you're at 30%. That's 40,000 arms. What are the biggest challenges when it comes to arm decommissioning?
Yung pong decommissioning process, Karen, ay isa lang sa 8 programs under the normalization track. So medyo complex ito. Ang pinaka-importante rito na maintindihan ng mga kababayan natin ay yung normalization track ay interlinked doon sa political track. So every political milestone, merong corresponding na action doon sa normalization. So like, nung pinirmahan natin yung Annex on Normalization, nagkaroon ng symbolic decommissioning. Ito yung 145 combatants and firearms. Nung naipasa at naratipika yung organic law, nagkaroon ng 30% na decommissioning ng MILF combatants and weapons. Mm-hmm. The next phase and the important political milestone for normalization to proceed ay magkaroon tayo ng operationalization ng police force for the Bangsamoro. This will trigger 35% of the decommissioning for MILF combatants and weapons. So unless nangyayari yung political milestones, hindi nangyayari yung decommissioning.
On the part of normalization track, may 4 aspects po yun. Number one is the security aspect, and it is highlighted by the decommissioning process. Since March 2020, year po na to, we have already decommissioned almost 12,000 former combatants. That is 1.2 billion pesos on the part of the government because we provided each combatant 100,000 pesos.
Yes.
Representing the transitory cash assistance lodged on the DSWD. Again, there are still some programs, not only on the individual aspect, but also on the part of community development. On the individual, we have the program of what we call TUPAD by DOLE, which provides or give benefits to 4,853 decommissioned combatants, amounting to almost 43 million. Marami pa po tayong mga projects and programs, not only from DSWD, from DOLE, from NAIA, DTI, as well as DOH, and on the pipelines also, we have also from the TESDA, technical vocational.
More questions coming in from social media. Ron Cruz has those questions, Ron.
On Twitter, Ferge asks, how would local groups affiliated with the organization Islamic State affect the prospects of BARM and peace process in general? Would our panelists like to answer that question?
Yes, it's admitted that we are beset by the challenges of violent extremism in the region. Alam po naman natin na yung ideology na to is a foreign ideology that's being introduced into the country. Ang ideology na to, pagka wala ho siyang nasasakyan na legitimate na grievance, kasi hindi naman po pwedeng ituro na pumatay lang ng tao regardless of civilian or not, kasi wala hong maniniwala doon. So yung ideology na to kinocover doon sa legitimate na grievances ng mga Bangsamoro, kaya nakaka-attract siya ng adherence. So if we remove the legitimate grievances by squarely addressing these legitimate grievances of our people, such as the demand for political participation, the right to self-determination, equitable economic development in the countryside, in the Bangsamoro, then we will take out the camouflage, the front of the violent extremists and expose yung real ideology nila. So pag hindi ho na-confuse yung mga tao, they will not gain following in the Bangsamoro. Any movement that is not supported by the people will never succeed.
We have Annabel Ismael of the Federation of Royal Sultanate Descendants of Mintsupala. Ms. Ismael, your question, please.
The 2022 national election and local elections is approaching. BARM, as a new entity, is supposed to have its first election of officials in May 22, 2022, as provided in the BOL. Suppose that the BTA or extension of BTA will be considered and approved by the Congress and our President, how does this affect the conduct of elections in our local government units within the BARM territory?
Yung pong pag na-reset yung elections at the regional level, that is at the level of the parliament, mapufocus lang yung election doon sa local at saka sa national. Less problematic ho yun, less complex. Kesa kasali pa yung regional elections kung saan magpa-participate yung mga bagong political parties like the United Bangsamoro Justice Party of the MILF. Yun ho yung panawagan kung bakit kasama doon sa reason for postponing the regional election para ho hindi lalong maging magulo yung elections natin in 2022 and that we can just focus on ensuring that we will have a clean, honest, and elections in the region at hindi na ma-complicate pa nung regional elections in the parliament.
We'd like to thank our panelists, Minister Naguib Sinarimbo and Assistant Secretary Wilben Mayor. Again, to those who are watching us, feel free to join us in this conversation by scanning that QR code you see on your screens or by clicking the quick survey link below. Up next, how will BARM ensure the inclusion, protection, and promotion of rights of various sectors, especially women, the youth, and Indigenous people? Stay with us. You're watching ANC Presents Bangsamoro and Beyond, produced in partnership with BARM, the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, HOPOP, the Office of the Presidential Advisor in the Peace Process, the Asia Foundation, and the British Embassy in Manila.
promise of reform lies in the parliamentary democratic system under the new Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, or BARM. The setup, similar to that of the United Kingdom, hopes to encourage inclusive and participatory governance among residents in the region.
Essentially, the undertaking is to build a political system which is strong and which is built on consent. And you know, at the center of that has to be a high level of political engagement and high levels of political participation across all groups, across all sectors of society. The strength of these institutions, the strength of this political process, rests on that high level of political participation and the inclusive systems that are being established. And I hope, as I say, through our work with the authorities, we're able to make our contribution to achieving that.
The unique features of a parliamentary form of government can help serve the development needs in the Bangsamoro. The Bangsamoro is considered the country's least developed region with the lowest household incomes, according to a 2015 study made by the Philippine Statistics Authority. According to the International Labor Organization in October 2020, the region also has the highest unemployment rate. The region also suffers from high rates of violence, according to the Asia Foundation in 2013. With armed groups operating in various areas of the Bangsamoro, levels of displacement continue to be high. This political system hopes to promote genuine and principled political parties, encouraging marginalized and underrepresented sectors in the Bangsamoro to finally have a voice in the region. In the parliament under BARM, there have been reserved and sectoral seats for various sectors, including non-Moro indigenous peoples, women, traditional leaders, youth, and the ulama. Bangsamoro women are often at the forefront in transforming their communities and helping those who are in need. But they're often economically marginalized, denied access to education, as well as employment. Advocates hope that these sectors will not be left behind in the BARM and that it will be gender responsive. The new Bangsamoro government will have to institute and implement policies that protect women and children and promote their rights. The issues and needs of various underrepresented and marginalized sectors, including women, youth, and indigenous peoples, must be considered and highlighted to ensure the region's leaders would reflect them in their legislative and policy agenda. Indeed, the work is far from over.
Thanks for joining us. We're now with Minister Raisa Jajuri of BARM's Ministry of Social Services and Development, Lawyer Laisa Alamia, Minority Leader of the Bangsamoro Parliament, and BARM Regional Election Director Ray Somalipao. We'd like to know, are political participation and voting rights enhanced under the BARM?
Actually, in preparation for the coming elections, and of course that would include the parliamentary elections in BARM, unless of course there will be a legislation resetting the same. We are on the registration, and of course, being the objective of the commission to include all that are who are qualified to vote, we have this continuing registration, and of course, in order to have, being the list of voters being the foundation of any electoral process, we have this APS project, and that is matching of these registration records with other records nationwide. I would like to stress that the matching will be nationwide. So it's quite impossible for one person to maintain two registration records. Mm-hmm. So we have this for every ERB, or the so-called ERB hearing, or Election Registration Board hearing. The AFIS will be distributed to all of the election officers in order to disapprove those applicants for registration or who have already registration records. We have to note that even if they are maintaining different names, different because of the AFIS, or the so-called automated fingerprint scanning, the same will be identified. And all of those years application for registration will be denied.
Have there been challenges when it comes to registration, sir?
The number one reason is the pandemic. Although our commission have innovated some online projects in order to have the participation of those who are at least apprehensive in coming into the office of the election officer, to have the scheduling in online. Still, the turnout is not as expected. Maybe it's only about 30% of the expected turnout, or based on the previous registration we have in the previous prior to any elections.
I'd like to talk to Riza and also Attorney Liza right now. How will the new Bangsamoro government encourage genuine and meaningful participation of various sectors, especially the marginalized ones, when it comes to governance?
I think the BOL is very clear when it says that the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region shall have a democratic political system, and that people will be allowed to freely participate in the political processes in the region. So this will also be reflected in the ways that we elect our members of the parliament. As mentioned earlier, there will be three categories of seats. One half of the seats will be elected through proportional representation, and the 40% to district representation, and then there will be 10% reserved for the different sectors. This means that people who may not be from the known political parties may participate directly by participating or joining a political party that vies for the party representation. Because here, the nominee, the candidate is the party, and the candidate, which is the party, will then provide for the nominees, who will then sit in accordance with the number of seats, no? A number of votes garnered, they will have a proportional number of seats in the parliament. The reserved seats will also allow our marginalized sectors, our vulnerable sectors, the numerical minorities also, to be part of the parliament by reserving seats for them. So there will be two seats each for the non-Moro indigenous peoples and the settler communities, and one seat each for youth, women, traditional leaders, and the ulama. So this will change the rules of the game, so to speak. Yeah.
Attorney Liza, gender equality in terms of culture, do you see that as a challenge when it comes to governance?
For now, Karen, you will find that under the law, we have national laws and we have laws already in the BARM government, which support gender equality, gender justice, and gender equity. All of the principles that are required when it comes to gender. There are also laws that are we are drafting right now, like the Gender Development Code. And at the same time, you will find in the Bangsamoro Organic Law that there are several provisions that promote and protect the rights of women. In addition to that, with respect to gender, so there will be more participation of women and other sectors. We'll also find in the Bangsamoro Organic Law that the government, it's part of the powers of the parliament, may call for a referendum on important issues affecting the Bangsamoro region. And then we may also enact a law on initiatives. Now, all of these referendum mechanisms assure that the people are consulted and all sectors are consulted and have a direct participation in decision making. The initiatives, for example, grant the electorate the right to repeal and act and amend local and regional legislation. So there are many avenues upon which women are able to participate.
If it's only one assured seat for a woman, do you feel the issues of women, frankly, might be may not be prioritized, or the concerns of women and the youth?
Yes, there's only one assured seat, yeah. But it says it's an at least, no? Meaning it can be, there can be more women in the parliament who will bring in the agenda of women. And hopefully, as provided in the Bangsamoro Organic Law, the political parties should also have their women's agenda, and that they should ensure that women and the youth are actively participate in the nomination process. Aside from the parliament, of course, we have different offices in the executive side, no, of the Bangsamoro government. We have the Bangsamoro Women's Commission, for example, for the women, the Bangsamoro Youth Commission for the youth, and so forth. No, these are policy-making bodies. They are coordinative. They influence the agenda of the Bangsamoro government and should be a venue for facing issues of women.
All right. Now, let's be specific. Attorney Liza and Riza, perhaps you can share with us, what are the top three concerns of women in BARM?
For many of us, at least particularly in these times, no? The socioeconomic status of the family is a primordial concern, particularly of women who have to fend for the other members of the family to take care of them. And so when there is not enough resources for food, for education, that's a concern for them, for themselves, as well as for their families, because of their traditional role as, you know, the one who takes care of the family.
With respect to the voices, yes, there are provisions in the Bangsamoro Organic Law that provide for seats, the participation of women, and the protection of our rights. However, we know that in the lived realities of women, not just in the BARM, but in the whole country, even if women are there, if they don't have voices, if they're not the ones making the decisions, or if they're just there because they're proxy decision makers of the men who are the more powerful ones in the clan, in the family, in the political party, then it would not be a meaningful participation. So I think it's a top priority also to make sure that Bangsamoro women are empowered. And to do that, we need to do more. We'll start with education. We'll start with orientation and making sure that we push women and help women to come out into the open and be part of the decision-making process within the autonomous region.
Questions and comments are coming in on social media via the hashtag BangsaForum, and Ron Cruz is monitoring those messages. Ron?
Now, on Facebook, Ernesto Barbante is wondering, how will the Bangsamoro government ensure the protection of the rights and agenda of the indigenous peoples in the region, given that the Indigenous Peoples Rights Act of 1997 is not operationalized in BARM? Now, he's also hoping that the law is also implemented or set for implementation in the transition process. Ernesto is also hoping for better participation of the indigenous peoples and non-Moro settlers in the efforts of the Bangsamoro Youth Commission, as well as peace-building campaign. Now, on Facebook, Alex Serrano says the best way for the region to develop is to have a new railway line from Marawi City to Cotabato City and to be extended later to Iligan City to the north and General Santos City to the south. Now, we have a question from the audience. We are joined by Ona Jaritos, the Executive Director of the Legal Network for Truthful Elections. Go ahead, Attorney Jaritos.
I have a question for Director Sumalipao. My question is, what can COMELEC do, or what has COMELEC done to ensure that the fears, the COVID fears of the three honorable members of our House of Representatives who filed the bills to postpone the 2022 BARM parliamentary election? So what has COMELEC done, or what does COMELEC entails to do or plans to do in the future to address these fears?
Aside from the minimum requirements under the present setup, we implement the same, especially now. We are on registration. Of course, we have to implement the minimum requirements of the Department of Health. But insofar as election is concerned, and it's it will only not cover Bangsamoro, the national COMELEC is entertaining the idea of having two-day elections or schedule. But this is actually some of those who will have to decide, and of course lay down the mechanics. So in order to diffuse, and of course the number of those coming in for the elections, then the COMELEC is making a study on this to make the elections two or three days. And secondly, of course, they also considering the extension of a longer voting period for these elections, just to give opportunities to all with such a safe scene in the polling stations. And of course that we also cover the Bangsamoro parliamentary elections.
Here's another question from Raymond King Temorio. He's the General Secretary of the United Indigenous Peoples Youth Organization and Technical Staff of the Provincial IMPR, or Indigenous Peoples Mandatory Representative. Raymond, go ahead.
Paano po makakasiguro ang mga kabataang NMIPs na ang kanilang representative ay pipiliin sa pamamagitan ng kanilang customary laws sa BYC? Paano po sila makakasiguro na kanilang representative sa BYC ay legitimate IT? Legitimate IT youth, because we believe that only the real IPs recommended by the IP community can articulate and raise the issues and concerns.
The BOL as a legal framework has ensured allocated sectoral seats for specifically for the youth and for indigenous peoples. Now, the purpose is to safeguard the representation and participation of the marginalized and those that are underrepresented in the parliament. However, while this alone cannot fully ensure that the issues and agenda surrounding the youth and the IP will be fully represented, these BOL provisions are promising, especially when complemented with other reforms. So what are these other reforms? Well, for now, we have created the Bangsamoro Youth Commission. There is also a Ministry of Indigenous Peoples Affairs. Aside from that, there are other programs that are being implemented or would be implemented in 2021 by these two agencies. Now, the marginalized and the underrepresented, like the IPs and the youth, are not foreclosed from pursuing elections for other parliamentary seats. That's the other avenue that they can come in, such as those allocated for party representatives and parliamentary districts. I think plus there are BOL provisions that provide that the government should adhere to the customary laws and indigenous processes based on the primacy of customary laws and practices of the IPs. And then there should be consensus building. It should be acceptable to the community. There is inclusivity and full participation of all the IPs, different IP groups. So there are IPs not just in Maguindanao, in South Upi. There are IPs all over Guam, also in the island provinces. So all of their concerns should be represented, and hopefully within the parliament, the discussion within the parliament is robust with respect to IPs and with respect to the youth.
We're also joined by Ana Basman, a member of the interim Bangsamoro Parliament. Honorable Basman, welcome to the program.
Two simple questions: why extend and why for 3 years? Number one, it's not just the BARM that is transitioning; it's the whole of the instrumentalities of the government that is actually undergoing this period of adjusting to this new system that we have now called the Bangsamoro. Second, we're a product of peace process, so we shouldn't look at this at a vacuum and see this only as a simple, or not even that, but as a matter of installing people in government. We are talking about, as a minister Sinarimbo mentioned earlier, we're talking about members of a rebel organization, of a revolutionary organization that have decided to join the government. So there are multiple internal and external processes that are at play and are simultaneously happening. So the capacity building on the side of the members of the MILF, and the decommissioning on the side of, which is a process at play with the Office of the Presidential Advisor and the peace process. And third, unlike the FTA, where the final peace agreement with the MNLF, where we decided to install members of the MNLF in an improved, admittedly, but almost similar system of government, now we've asked people who have zero to very little to none to no experience in government to not just run the government but change it. So those are the primary reasons why 3 years is not enough, and why an additional 3 years, for the practical reason, I think, that we want to synchronize elections in 2025, and so we ask for an additional 3 years so that we don't need to change the schedule of elections for the regional government.
Thank you, Honorable Basman. We appreciate your thoughts. We'd also like to thank Attorney Laysa Alamia, the Minority Leader, Minister Raisa Jajuri of the Social Services Department, and the BARM Regional Election Director, Ray Sumalipao. To those who are watching us, feel free to join us in this conversation by scanning the QR code you see on your screens or by clicking the quick survey link below. I'm Ron Cruz.
And thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for gracing us with your presence today. I'm Karen Davila. This is ANC Presents Bangsamoro and Beyond, produced in partnership with BARM, the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, OPAP, the Office of the Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process, the Asia Foundation, and the British Embassy in Manila.